В сущности, и ваше начальство, и все вы, ну, ленивы, сударь, ленивы.
Do you ever watch a movie and catch yourself thinking, when was the last cut? And at that point, you realize this shot has lasted for a minute, 2 minutes, 10 minutes, or more, and you just watch in awe, captivated by the technical challenge the filmmakers underwent to pull it off, and the sheer courage and audacity they had to have had to do it. But when someone implements a long take into their film, or they make their film at least seem like one continuous shot, they ride a thin line between artistic and gimmicky. It's all about why. Why are they shooting the film as a continuous shot? What is the purpose and the intended effect? Such questions have cropped up recently with the release of 1917, as the film gives the illusion of a single take. It won the Oscar for Best Cinematography, but the film as a whole seemed to divide audiences into two camps, those who loved it, and then the people like me, who thought that it was just alright. Why didn't I love it? Well, it has a lot to do with how I find its long take gimmicky. But before I dive into why, let's take a look at the history of the long take. If we were to jump back to the start of cinema, I could argue that the first one-shot films were films like Workers Leaving the Lumiere Factory in 1895, but that wouldn't be too honest of me, as these films were incredibly short and weren't exactly films as we know them today. So I'm going to jump ahead 53 years to a film that people often cite as one of, if not the oldest, film to simulate one continuous shot, Alfred Hitchcock's Rope. Alfred Hitchcock released Rope in 1948. Adapted from a Patrick Hamilton stage play, Rope was both Hitchcock's first color film and his first and only film to mostly resemble one long shot. The effect it had was that it felt like a play, but on the silver screen. Hitchcock enjoyed the best of both worlds, the feeling of the film being a stage play, with it taking place in real time, but he also got to direct the viewer's eyes with the camera, so Hitchcock could build tension from what we couldn't see, something that could not happen on stage. There are a couple caveats to Rope's continuous shot, though, and by caveats, I mean cuts. For one, there are a couple hard cuts in the film, such as when Philip shouts,
"Rose, that's a lie!
And the camera cuts to Jimmy Stewart. Hitchcock also didn't hide the cuts very well in Rope. The camera would zoom into the backs of people, and the screen would turn black for a few frames before going into the next segment. But these were due to technical limitations of the time. For one, the Technicolor three-strip camera was massive and clunky, not lending itself to easy movement. But it would have been hard with just about any camera at the time, since just about every 35mm camera was big and noisy, needing blimps to mute the sound of the camera motors. Cameras got smaller and easier to handle as time progressed, which resulted in filmmakers utilizing more handheld shots, and it allowed for tools like the Steadicam to be made and used on a massive scale. But no matter how lightweight film cameras could become, there is one big limitation all of those cameras face: the film. A full magazine, or 1,000 feet of film, on a 35mm camera can only record about 11 minutes of footage. Once all the film has passed through the gate, you can't shoot anymore until you reload the film. Also, the film takes up quite a bit of space, so no matter how small the actual camera is, the magazine on top of it or behind it can hinder portability. The lack of playback made it extremely hard on sets to link shots together, and flatbeds did not give the versatility that modern digital, non-linear editing programs provide. Needless to say, shooting a film is one shot didn't catch on. That's not to say that long shots and sequence shots weren't popular, though. The opening shot to Orson Welles' Touch of Evil is a masterclass in how to open a film and how to shoot a long take. Spielberg famously works in a one-er, or a scene or sequence captured in one shot, into most of his movies. Andy Warhol made his film Empire, which is over 8 hours long and is composed of just one angle of the Empire State Building. Long takes were also popular in European cinema, with directors like Antonioni, Tarkovsky, Angelopoulos, and Tarr using especially long takes in many of their films. Long takes can be used to build tension, give the audience some room to breathe and think, or just simply exist as a technical flourish. But films in the 20th century weren't made as one continuous take. Even Baylitar's Macbeth is composed of two shots. It wasn't until the 21st century that films shot as one continuous shot would see a rise in popularity. So what changed? Well, to put it simply, the rise of the one-shot movie coincided with the rise of digital cinematography. Digital cameras are, by and large, smaller and more lightweight. Furthermore, digital cameras don't require large film magazines, and there isn't a hard limit on how much cameras can record. It all depends upon the memory of the cards or drives to which the camera is recording. That's not to mention the ability to watch playback on digital cameras. Now, there is still an ongoing debate concerning the image quality between film and digital, but that is a rabbit hole I could not afford to jump into in this video. Let's take a look at one of the earliest, and perhaps one of the most important, digital film films shot in one continuous take, Russian Ark. Shot at the Russian State Hermitage Museum in St. Petersburg, the film follows a 19th century French aristocrat walking through the museum, wherein we witness over 200 years of Russian history. It took over 4,500 people to make the film, and the filmmakers only had one day in which to shoot. Their fourth take was the only successful take. The effect the long take has on us, the viewers, is that we feel like we are walking through the museum. In a way, it places the audience as the protagonist, following a guide through Russian history. It's hypnotic, dreamlike, and awe-inspiring. But here's a funny thing. Not many films after this were shot in just one take. PVC 1 and Victoria were shot in one take, but not Birdman, nor 1917. Why is that? Well, these newer digital cinema cameras, the Arri Alexa XT in Birdman's case, and the Arri Mini LF in 1917's case, don't have the capacity to record an entire feature film when shooting in RAW. Shooting at 3.2K, the most Lubezki could shoot at a time in Birdman was 46 minutes and 1 second. For Deakins, the longest he could possibly roll for, 1917, granted that he was shooting with a 2.39 by 1 aspect ratio and at 4.5K resolution, was 53 minutes and 44 seconds. It would have been considerably less time if he shot with an open gate. The reason they don't have the capacity to record an entire feature film is simply because of how large their data files are. 53 minutes and 44 seconds of shooting on the Arri Mini LF takes up a full terabyte of information. Sure, these cameras may be able to record for longer than celluloid film cameras, but as resolutions rise and digital color science advances, the video files occupy larger and larger spaces, which further limits how long the cameras can roll, unless storage capacity keeps up with the new sensors. So, since these filmmakers can't shoot an entire film in one go, they must segment the film into shots and edit them together to appear seamless. It's funny that we're right back to using some of the techniques Hitchcock used in Rope, albeit now with technology that makes it easier to pull off. But trust me, nothing about making a film looking like one take is easy. There are other limitations to shooting a film in one take, or making it appear so, such as the placement of lights and gear, the pressure of the actors to not mess up, the constant coordination between the whole cast and crew, the reliability of every piece of tech used, whether it's the focus puller, mixing board, boom mic, or director's monitor. And if any of your film is outside, you've got to think about the weather. What would Deakins do if halfway through shooting 1917, the sky opened up and just started pouring down on him? If you knew how expensive that camera was, you would not want it getting wet. Lubezki admitted that the longest take in Birdman was about 15 minutes, but that most shots lasted around 10 minutes apiece. He, Innaritu, and his editors cut in the camera pans, so one of the challenges they faced in making the film look like one shot was matching speed, both the speed of the camera and the speed of the actors. 1917's longest take is estimated to be about 8 minutes long, so each shot in the film is relatively shorter than a shot in Birdman, but that is still a far cry from the average shot length in modern films, which is about 2.5 seconds. That means that 1917's longest shot is 192 times longer than the average shot in a modern movie. For both of these films, shooting the films to appear as one take also increased the pressure before pre-production, as the writers understood that nothing in the films could be cut. No extraneous or poor scene could find its way to the cutting room floor. The scripts had to be airtight, uncuttable. If there was a bad scene in the movie, then there was no way for them to remove it. So the writers had to work extra hard on polishing the scripts before their productions began. But let's look at the most important part of all of this, the effect the long take gives. Let's start with Birdman. Birdman blends theater with film in its story, characters, and form. Brigand is a washed-up film actor writing, directing, and starring in a Broadway play. Just like how he is a film actor in a theatrical play, Birdman the movie is a cinematic piece within the theater. The long take gives a feeling of the movie being like a play, but its refusal to cut also dramatically increases the tension, allowing the audience to witness and feel the increasing stress of the play and Reagan's simultaneous mental decay. Thus, the use of the long continuous shot feels natural to the film as it expands upon the film's themes and elevates its atmosphere. On the other hand, and trust me, I know this is a hot take, I don't think the use of the long continuous shot achieved its artistic goal in 1917. And if you're a fan of 1917, which I know many of you are, please hear me out, because from my experience of talking with other people who liked it, the reason it didn't work for me is precisely the reason it worked for others. A common criticism of 1917 is that it feels like a video game, which is an interesting criticism considering that Mendez and Deakins made the film look and feel like one, or rather two, shots in order to make the film feel more immersive, but to many people, it had the opposite effect. So we have to ask ourselves, what came first, the script or the idea of the long take? I can't answer that question myself, but watching the film, I get the feeling that Mendez and Wilson Cairns wrote the script to be shot in a continuous take, which would heavily influence the progression of the story. For one, there's more emphasis on Schofield actually getting to the destination. Since so much of the emphasis is on the physical journey, there isn't much emphasis on his emotional journey. Mendez diversifies the scenery, with cameos by famous British actors marking almost every sequence. But the famous actors are generally there to progress the plot, whether it's giving him orders, directions, or a ride, rather than deepen the film. It does give the impression of a video game. As a small side note, the scene in which Schofield and Blake run through the crumbling bunker reminds me of an interactive cutscene in a game like Uncharted. There's also the issue of time when it comes to using a continuous shot. What we see on screen has to happen in real time. That's why there's a hard cut in the middle of the film to jump us ahead several hours to early dawn. But for a technique used to heighten immersion, it requires immersion-breaking scenes in the script. After Blake's death, Mark Strong and his troops happen upon the farmhouse to find Schofield mourning the loss of his friend. It gives a feeling that, within the couple minutes in which Blake was dying, all these trucks and military personnel showed up to the house without the character or the audience hearing them. It comes across as a cheap way to transport Schofield closer to his final destination by giving him a truck in which to ride. And so, I believe that the use of the continuous shot strangled 1917. It demands a constant forward momentum, but not a forward momentum of drama and characters. Schofield keeps moving, but we never really get to know who Schofield and Blake even are. Thus, the emotional scenes in the film feel unearned. The use of the continuous take also, in my opinion, took away some potential tension and emotional resonance. I know I said earlier that long takes can increase tension, but so can editing. The scene in which Schofield crosses the downed bridge could have been incredibly tense if we could see the point of view of the shooter. It would have introduced the kind of dramatic irony that is great for building suspense. But when the film is one continuous shot and the focus is solely on the main character, something like that can't be done. As for how editing could have made the film more emotional, let's look at the scene near the end, wherein the man sings to the troops. Now, this is my favorite scene in the film, but I can't shake the feeling that it would have been so much better if we could get close-ups of the singer and the soldiers' faces to really feel their emotion. What we get is the backs of their heads and then a dolly in on Schofield. Just compare this scene to a scene in the movie Brooklyn where an old Irish man sings, and you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. Great war movies use war to explore something else. Saving Private Ryan explores notions of brotherhood. The Thin Red Line is about spirituality, God, love, and morals. And Apocalypse Now, which is also about a journey with stations along the way, is about madness and evil. 1917 is about completing the objective. Perhaps, if the filmmakers decided to focus on substance over style, it could have been great. I wanted it to be great, but the usage of the long take just didn't fit 1917 nearly as well as it fit Birdman or Russian Ark. I still don't think it's a bad movie, but it's not a memorable one either. Let's not end this video on a down note though. If you like long takes, I got a couple films to recommend that you probably haven't seen. The first film is The Tribe, a Ukrainian film from 2014 in which all the characters speak in Ukrainian sign language and there are no subtitles. There are also only 34 shots in the whole film, making its average shot length 3.7 minutes. The long steadicam takes and the lack of understanding of what's being said make it a riveting and utterly brutal experience. When I saw it at Sundance, it caused the lady singing in front of me to pass out, so watch at your own risk. The second film I'm going to recommend is not near as disturbing, but probably more artsy, and that is Baygon's, forgive me if I'm saying this incorrectly, film Long Day's Journey into Night. The first half of the film feels like a Tarkovsky movie, but the second part of the film is done as one long shot through minds, and then through a surreal, dreamlike town that is a culmination of the protagonist's consciousness, memories, and desires. The camera floats and flies, making you feel like you're dreaming. It was also filmed in 3D. It's truly something to behold. So do you like long takes? If so, what films do you feel utilize long takes the best? The Player, Enter the Void, Children of Men, Nostalghia? Let me know down in the comments. If you like this video and want to see more content like this, consider giving this a like and subscribing. I will see you all in the next video.